Thanks everyone for joining. I hope you're enjoying RSA. It's awesome to be back in person and great to see people in person. A lot of people I get to see this week are people I hadn't seen since 2019. I love meeting friends and making new ones, so it's really great. So thanks for joining this session. Oh, no problem. So my talk is on building attacks or cloud-based pentesting platforms. So disclaimer, presentations are for educational purposes. And this is used for pentesting, so I'm not encouraging people to set up these for malicious purposes. So that disclaimer in there. So a little bit about my background. I used to work as a pentester, spent 10 years in that space, a little over 18 years in cybersecurity as a whole, spent like 6 years in application security. Application security is what got me interested in pentesting. I'm a former adjunct professor. I used to teach web app pentesting and pentesting at Dallas College. And this was actually the inspiration for my book, The Pentester Blueprint, which we'll be doing a book signing after this, if you're interested in getting the book. But it was inspired by my first day of class lecture each semester, telling students what the role of a pentester was like, the prerequisite knowledge that they needed, and some of the other professors at the college would ask me to come in and talk to their security students on becoming a pentester. So by, that was like January 2018 that I first gave the talk, lecture in school. By November 2018, I was giving the presentation on that topic at B-Sides DFW in Dallas-Fort Worth. And then I was in the Tribe of Hackers Red Team edition, and Wylie Publishing asked me if I was interested in writing a book. And so I'd had the idea of turning this into a book. So that's kind of the story behind that. I'm also the host of the Hacker Factory podcast. So if you're really interested in hearing stories on how people got started in cybersecurity, it's a good podcast. And it's good to recommend to anyone that you're mentoring or people you know that are trying to get in the industry, because there's so many different stories that are shared. People that went in from the medical industry, from people that were working. Actually, Patrick Lafferty was an aspiring herbalist, and he ended up going into, you know, he wanted to be a pro baseball player. So a lot of interesting stories. Dave Kennedy was a guest on there, as well as Alyssa Knight. So very interesting content there, and actually one of our participants in the audience today was actually one of my guests on the podcast. So kind of going into this, so this is the inspiration for this talk was I did an article on Medium a couple years ago on building a pentesting laptop. And a lot of the stuff I do is to educate people that are not in offensive security to learn more about that. So I wrote this article on how to set up a pentesting laptop, and someone said, hey, could you do one on a cloud-based pentesting platform? And so with cloud-based pentesting, well, consulting companies and even companies that do their own pentesting, you need a way to test your external facing assets. So hosting something in the cloud is the best way to do that. And a lot of people may have ran into this at work, that the latest threat was out and your manager wanted you to go out and scan all the external assets, test for anything that's external facing, and see if it's vulnerable to any of those vulnerabilities on the latest exploit that's out there, the latest OD. So in this, we're going to cover pentesting overview, common pentest types, just kind of lay the groundwork for those who are not familiar with that. And then we'll talk about the pentester perspective and pentesting platforms. So pentesting are also referred to as ethical hacking. It's doing security assessments from a threat actor perspective as a malicious hacker. So that's the best way to test your security, is from a threat actor perspective, because running a vulnerability scan, you may see that there are things that are exploitable. Maybe you can get past that first layer, but you really don't know unless you try privileged escalation, lateral movement, and so on. So it's important to do that. So, and then red team or adversary emulation is scenario-based assessments, emulating threat actors, even simulating specific APTs. And the goal of red team operation is to simulate real-world breaches. So the difference between like a pen test and red team, there's a lot of confusion in the industry, because true red teaming is adversary emulation. So you're trying to emulate an adversary. And with a red team engagement, you're going through trying to find vulnerabilities that could be exploited to lead to a breach. So that's what you're doing in that scenario. With a pen test, and they're both important that you do both of these. With a pen test, you're trying to find all the vulnerabilities that are exploitable and try to exploit anything that's exploitable. So you know, if you were just doing red teaming, then there'd be a lot of things you would miss by not doing the penetration test. So they're both very important. And one of the best descriptions for red teaming was from Wirefall, the founder of Dallas Hackers Association, was the red team tests the blue team. So you're testing the reactions of the defenders as well as the technology, reaction times, and all that. So there's common pen test types, and these are the type of targets that you're testing. So external network, and this is really where cloud-based pen testing platforms come into play. Internal network, Wi-Fi network, web application cloud, and hardware. And every day we keep getting more and more stuff. I mean, there's even more things, Bluetooth and Zigbee and some other type of wireless technologies that you would see in OT environments. But the main focus is going to be external networks, so we're just kind of laying the foundation here. So pen testing perspective, we're focused on external and internal networks, but you know the main focus with the cloud is going to be external. So external networks and internal networks have to be tested routinely, and this is one of the more common types of pen tests that you see. And so the pen testing platforms for internal is going to be computers, so you got whatever your standalone computer, it could be servers, you could have shared servers. I've worked in organizations where we had our own laptops to test with, and some organizations where you have a shared server. Virtual machines, a lot of times, you know, a lot of shops are heavy with VMware, and so we've got various multiple servers running in the environment to be able to test. And then drop boxes, so be able to test covertly. Sometimes you go into organizations and take like your different Hack 5 devices and drop off internally to test things internally to try to sneak in and hide them in certain places when you're doing more of a red team engagement. And then hacking, especially hardware. So as you know, we mentioned some of the drop boxes and stuff, so the Hack 5 devices that are very popular and very user-friendly to use. And one of the things, if you haven't used the Hack 5 stuff, it's a lot easier to do Wi-Fi pen testing with one of the Hack 5 devices than setting it up manually, although I recommend learning how to do everything manually before you get into something that makes it easy. And so external platform goals. So to be able to test external facing network assets from the internet. So as I mentioned before, we need to be able to test externally. Most of the companies I worked for, we had like cloud-based platforms. In some cases, we were just using a VPN and a standalone computer and just going through the VPN. Part of the good thing about using the cloud or going through a VPN is it's easier to give someone a range of IP addresses to put on the allow list. That way you're able to perform the test. You could put them to block, but you're just not getting true results of a pen test. What happens if your WAF or other firewalls fail? You're able to get past that and get in the network. So you definitely want to make sure that those items are on the allow list. But it's good if you want to test it both ways, see what is actually, you know, see what it's like with the firewall up. So it's good to do both ways, but if you do it with just the allow list, then you're kind of not seeing what's possible. So you want to test both of those. So make sure you can see what happens if an actual attacker tries to gain access. And also you have insider threats sometimes that someone may be coming in that's on an allow list. So you definitely want to keep all those scenarios in mind when you're doing that. And so external pen testing platform goals, ability to test external facing networks from the internet. And so you got remote on-prem solutions, so you could have your own data center set up. When I was first getting started in pen testing, some of the consulting companies I work for, some cases we just had a VPN or proxy server set up that we connect and test through that for our external testing. And that was the way that was done, and the on-prem, remote on-prem was kind of one of the more popular solutions starting out back then. So this was back in 2012 when I was first getting my start up into more recent years. Working for companies that had stuff hosted at AWS and a lot more elaborate solution than just using a VPN or just a standalone server in the cloud or in a data center. So remote on-prem disadvantages in home office scenarios, possible service disruption. So while you're testing, maybe you lose power. You could lose internet. So we run into a lot of these things. You know, sometimes you have power outages certain times of the year. And like in Texas, we had back in February of 2021, we had a lot of outages. So we were out days. So anyone that had to pen test remotely would have had a difficult time because you wouldn't have power for your internet. You could tether to your phone, hopefully, and your UPS would have run out by some point. So that's some of the challenges that you see there, is the power disruption and bandwidth limitations. Sometimes maybe the area your remote employees are working in may not have very fast internet. I mean, this people live in big cities may sound unbelievable, but like my in-laws, for instance, they live in a small rural town north of Wichita Falls, and they've still got like their internet there. They don't even have anything close to gigabit. It's probably 200 megabit at most. So bandwidth limitations and scalability limitations. So you add new people, you know, you're able to say like you're doing a pen test and you need a password hash cracking machine to use. You've got that and you can share that internally. So any kind of machine you need, the VPS you need to spin up, then it's more scalable. You can add to that. And using things like VMware makes it easier to spin up other servers. So it's easy to add to that compared to like the bare metal installs that people were more familiar with in previous years. And so cloud-based solutions. So you got like your basic standalone virtual private server. A lot of times pen testers and bug bounty hunters will set these up in the cloud, just get a VPS through like DigitalOcean and use that, which is still a good solution. And the thing about the cloud-based platform, you can scale that on what you need. And the interesting thing about doing the VPS is like bug hunters, you're able to run your scripts overnight, let them run, not have to worry about disruption. You know, if you need to move on to another location, you can disconnect your laptop, go back and reconnect, and you know, be able to just share those resources with a team is great. So you can have multiple VMs, you know, it's highly scalable. You know, it's a good idea to have like your hash cracking rig separate from the rest of your machine, so that way you're not eating up all the computing power while you're trying to do your other testing. And so, like I said, it's highly scalable since, you know, all the, even get past VMware, some of the other orchestration stuff that they have available in the cloud to be able to quickly spin up other instances of servers. In one of my past careers, I was a sysadmin, and that was back before VMware really caught on. And so we had to build all our servers for bare metal installs, and the amount of time it took to do that. You know, some people got into using like Ghost and different imaging softwares to image that bare metal, which made things a little bit faster. Even some of the, one of the products HP had out that was for cloning servers. But then once we got into, you know, using virtualization, that made our lives easier. And so the benefits of a cloud-based pen testing platform, scalable solution from single virtual private server to multiple servers. And this is, you know, all based on, you know, your budget. If you're like a freelance pen tester, the nice thing is you can, you're only being billed by the hour. So when you're not needing it, you can shut it down and you're not wasting your AWS time. And so it's accessible from virtually anywhere. And so if you need to move locations, say if you're doing a internal pen test and you started your external scanning, then you can, you know, disconnect, go to your customer location, go inside and do your pen test while your scans are still running. And for anyone pen testing, make sure you're running screen or tmux or something like that during your scans, because if it ever crashes, then going back trying to SSH back to that session, anyone that's done that knows the nightmare that you've had your Nessus scans or Nmap scans running overnight. You try to go back and connect and you've lost everything. You got to start all over again. And sometimes those scans can take a long time. That's actually one of the motivations for me to first try mass scan. I was doing a pen test for a customer. We had so many IPs to do segmentation testing for a PCI pen test, was in there scanning, and I used mass scan. And this is my first experience learning that mass scan can be used for a denial of service tool if you scan too fast. I was at this company internally, a national or maybe global airlines, and so I was in there scanning one night and accidentally took down a couple of their legacy firewalls with mass scan. So I learned my lesson with that. But be able to connect back. So be able to access it from anywhere. Scalable and availability and sharing resources with teams. So there's really good products out there like PlexTrack that you can use to do report writing. And you can share that with the teams. And the good thing about those tools like PlexTrack, when you're writing your reports, you can collaborate. So someone's doing an internal pen test, someone's doing web, you can all have access to that. The old days, you would share your Word document or someone would write their piece. You have to go in and combine that at the end. So be able to share resources like that. Maybe you've got some password lists that you're able to more easily distribute and use, share as a team, than everyone having to have a copy on their own. So, and then just be able to, we mentioned a while ago, connectivity, just be able to download those quickly. You know, you're in the cloud, you're able to download those resources quickly to your server. So that's an advantage there too as well. And some different use cases allows company externally test external networks. And this could be consultants, this could be freelancers or bug hunters. And you know, the bug hunters, the really good ones have really caught on to using a cloud-based platform. They will set up scripts and let those run overnight. And they just periodically add new subdomains or domains to their to their list that they're using for their testing, let it run overnight, come back and see the results, and then they can do the more manual stuff on the pen testing. Same thing that, that pen testers can do as well. And this is really great for freelancers. If you're working freelancing for a good company, you'll have to do this own, but it's on your own. But it's kind of nice if you can do that, set up your own environment, and it makes life a lot easier. And server resource options. So dedicated hardware included bare metal, so you can have this in like a shared hardware solution in the cloud, virtual servers. So in my opinion, the virtual servers are kind of the best way to go. But some people still like bare metal. And so some of the vendors that are very popular and you that are used a lot in the industry, ones you don't hear as much about is Vulture is a pretty good resource. DigitalOcean is pretty good for using VPSs. This is a very affordable resource for someone that's a freelancer or a bug hunter. Then you have Linode and AWS that are good resources and very user-friendly. To that, one of the best cloud setups I'd used was actually set up in AWS, and you have the virtual workstation set up with AWS that you can remotely console in, and then SSH to any of your Linux VPSs that you have set up. And one solution scenario I saw where we had our drop boxes that we sent out to a client, we're able to SSH from some of the control servers in the cloud, kind of using in like almost like a command and control scenario internally to the company, and you're all able to access that through one console and have many servers. You know, Windows boxes, a lot of times people don't really think about using Windows boxes to do your pen testing, but there's a lot of great pen testing tools that are written for Windows, and a lot of Windows administrator tools that are very helpful. So having, you know, the opportunity to use Windows VMs and Linux VMs are very helpful. And some of the providers, you can actually install Kali Linux, and some of those you have to go with Ubuntu and install the tools manually. You know, there's a tool called Snap that you could use on Ubuntu to install tools, as well as the Pentester framework by TrustedSec is another good option to more easily install those tools. But the nice thing is when you can use Kali Linux, of course, or Parrot, it's a lot easier to install some of those tools, because trying to install some of those tools on Ubuntu sometimes it doesn't always go so smoothly. So here's some sample configurations, and this can be, you know, is a single server up to a virtual private cloud. So your Linux pen testing tools, vulnerability scanner, your command and control, so you're using something like Cobalt Strike or even something like Empire, you can set that up in the cloud. VPN for tunneling remotely, and you can set up SSH to connect that remotely. SOX proxy is really helpful to have on there for Burp Suite and even for OWASP Zap. And so multiple servers, you can have your Linux with pen testing tools, Windows with pen testing tools, vulnerability scanners, command and control. So you see there's a lot of similarity there. You just got more, you can be more specialized in your servers. Here you're able to add, you know, Windows machines to the mix. You can have a hash cracker on there. But, you know, it all depends on your budget. You may limit it to a single VPS. And you can scale that as you go along. And that's one of the nice things about cloud. You can always add more to it. Whereas the old days, if you rented a rack somewhere, something like Rackspace or something, a third-party hosting company, and put those devices in there, it was a little more cumbersome to get that set up. But with virtualization and all the tools to automate the cloud makes it a lot easier. And then the virtual private cloud, some of your bigger organizations, pen testing firms, this is the kind of setup that they would use. So you see the tools here are pretty much the same. You're just looking at a larger scale, because, you know, where some smaller firms, you may be a few pen testers, where you get to some of these bigger firms, you could have 10, 20 pen testers. Or if it's a scenario where you're using like some crowdsourced pen testing, then you may need more scalability. So you just be creative and configure what works best for you, and through trial and error, you'll kind of figure out things that work. And that's one of the things that's really been great about the industry is people have learned the how to put all that together and make things work better. And so conclusion, cloud-based pen testing platforms can improve your assessment experience by providing stable, scalable, available pen testing platforms, resource sharing, and capabilities for teams. So now we can open up to questions. So if anyone has any questions, please step up to the mic there.
Hi. Should you ever be concerned that the vendor that you choose shuts you down because of illegal activity or something that they consider malicious?
Yes, you'll want to talk to the vendor, and like AWS and even like Azure, you can do pen testing, but a lot of times you need to look on their site for reference and they'll tell you what to do, how to get approval. But companies like some of the other servers like DigitalOcean, they're more familiar with people doing that. So you just may let them know ahead of time what the use is for it. But yeah, but once you get that set up, you're usually good. Even you can even pen test those platforms as long as you get permission. But usually rules are less restrictive for people doing pen test opposed to actually pen testing the cloud. Anyone else? No other questions? Yes. Yeah. Yeah. If you could step up to the mic, they're recording the session so that way the people can hear on a recording. Oh yeah, that's okay. But at least the mic, they can pick it up for recording. So.
Okay. Are you hearing me? Okay. Perfect.
Yes.
So, are there? Do you recommend any other system that Kali and Parrot or? There's the other one, Arch version too.
Yeah.
So are there any other platform like you develop or online you have for like already built in and have the pen testing tools that you think it's useful to use, or any recommendation on that, or is just Kali or like build yours?
I think it's going to depend on how generic the install is. If it's a pretty generic type of install, Kali Linux or Parrot's going to work really well. I used to not be as big a fan of Parrot OS, but a couple years ago I had to do a Wi-Fi pen test, and I was running into all sorts of problems trying to get my alpha cards to work, and I ended up deciding to give Parrot a try, and everything worked so well, and they even had detailed instructions on how to set up your GPU, because by default it didn't install the GPU driver correctly. But I went on their site, and this is not even on a forum, this is actually one of their written documents from their company, gave detailed instructions on how to install that graphics driver, so that was a good solution. So I would go with those anytime you can, but you can use like the Pentester framework from TrustedSec, which is really good for installing tools, and then Snap like in Ubuntu. But the thing I find is most of the tools are written for Ubuntu or Debian-based systems, so that's really a better platform to stick to. Some of the other platforms I've seen people have built out really good for wireless. I'm trying to think if it was Arch Linux that people are using more for the wireless, because I know one of the wireless villages at DEF CON, they had a special build and it wasn't Kali Linux or Parrot, but I think it might have been Arch or something like that.
Also, you mentioned about the article that you did, basically how to build your computer as a pen tester.
Yes.
May I ask where can I find that? I'm interested
yes.
to see.
Yes, if you look on Medium, you can find it.
Okay.
On Medium, and then if you go to my Twitter, on Twitter, let me see if I got my contact information there. Yeah, if you go to my link tree there, you can find all of my stuff.
Okay.
And for anyone that's interested in just getting started in pen testing, I share like a whole semester of my ethical hacking lectures that I did. The course I taught was based on Pentest Plus, but also share some tips and tricks, walkthroughs, and industry experience. But I've got like a whole semester of those lectures out there based on the Pentest Plus. But yeah, if you go out there, there's a link to my Medium account, or if you look for Phillip Wylie on Medium, I've got that on there as well, and some articles that I wrote on Wi-Fi pen testing as well as manual pen testing. So I plan to do more of that. And also, if you check out some of the blogs at CyCognito, I've written some blogs there on optimizing pen testing and other pen testing related topics.
Okay. So the link is based on Linktree, am I right?
Yes. Okay. If you go to Linktree, you can find everything that I have out there.
Okay.
That's the
easiest
thing.
Thanks. Yeah. Thanks a lot.
You're welcome. Thank you for your questions. Yeah. Anyone else? Yes. If you could please step up the mic.
Do you feel like there's also like applications for the cloud-based pen testing frameworks in like the other kind of pen testing scenarios you talked about, like Wi-Fi pen testing, Zigbee, et cetera?
Yeah, with the Wi-Fi stuff, it gets a little more complicated. You'd have to have a Dropbox on site to be able to remotely control for the Wi-Fi stuff. So that's kind of, in that scenario, yeah, you would have to have something on site to be able to do that. And it's kind of interesting because before the pandemic, you didn't see people doing remote pen tests as much, but with the pandemic, a lot of companies, when they hire consultants, some companies still like the face-to-face. They want to see the consultant. They didn't really like the Dropbox mentality, but it's really caught on more. It was kind of interesting at DerbyCon back in 2018, Dell SecureWorks, they had this really elaborate Dropbox that they had set up out of a Pelican case that had all these antennas that they would ship out to a client. But you could do the wireless stuff. You would just have to remotely control whatever Dropbox is in that area. Thanks for the question. Anything else? And if you have any general pen testing questions at all, I'd be happy to answer those. And feel free to reach out to me on social media. I'd be happy to connect. I guess we have no more questions. That ends my presentation. And after this, I'll be doing a book signing over at the RSA bookstore if you're interested. Thank you.